We welcome you today at Coronado Community United Methodist. Glad you're here to worship with us. Let's invite you to stand together as you're able, and let's join together in our opening songs. Open the eyes of our hearts. We sing.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy. To see you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing, holy, holy, holy.
We say,
open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you. Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. See you high lifted up, shining in the light of your glory. Pour out your power and love as we sing.
It's higher than the mountains that I face, and it's stronger than the power of the grave. It's constant in the trial and the change. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Never runs out on me. Your love never fails. It's never gives up. Never runs out on me. Your love never fails. It never gives up. Never runs out on me. Your love. And on and on and on and on it goes. Yes, it overwhelms and satisfies my soul. Our hearts, O God, make them ever true. May we be like you. We sing together.
Change my heart, O God, make it ever true. Change my heart, O God, may I be like.
Father, we are gathered with your church this morning to sing praises to you in worship and give thanks for your love that never fails. Open our hearts to hear the word you have for us today, that we might grow in our faith. Mold us and make us to be more like you. Through your Son, we pray. Amen. We invite you to take a moment now. Let's say hello to one another. Pass the peace of Christ this morning.
Good morning, everybody. So good to see you enjoying one another. I love that. Be sure to say hi to the kids as they're on their way out. Welcome, welcome. Please, please, relax, relax. Would you join me in welcoming Barbara Gillum as she is making her way forward? We are thanking God for Barbara. And Barbara, you've got some stuff you want to share with us this morning.
Yes, we'd like to revive the flower ministry, where we take the altar flowers, divide them up into smaller vases, and deliver them to homebound members. And along with that, you can visit with them a little bit and let them know that we're still thinking of them and pray for them. And if they can't be here, at least they know we're still thinking of them.
And so, Barbara, there's going to be an organizational meeting for this. You want to tell us a little about that?
Yes, we're going to have an organizational meeting on Monday, September 30th at 2 p.m. If you're interested in coming and learning a little more about what we're doing and how we're going to do it. So you'd be delivering probably maybe once every couple months if we have enough people to volunteer. And we'll try to make the deliveries like in a certain area at a certain time. We'll be delivering to homes and to care facilities. And hopefully that'll all work out.
It's great. And Barbara, why is this important to you?
We did this in our church in Oklahoma before we came here, and my husband and I always enjoyed delivering the flowers and visiting with the people. I think they enjoy the visits more than the flowers, but it makes them know that we're still thinking of them.
Great. So thank you so much, Barb, for doing this. So this will be a part of our congregational care ministry here at the church. And so if you're interested in this, you can get a hold of Barb through the church office. We will connect you up with her. So if you're not able to make that organizational meeting, it's okay. Just let us know you're interested, and we'll get you connected up. I'd like to invite the ushers forward for our morning offering. God of grace and hope, we thank you for the gift of the rain, and we thank you for the gift of the sunshine. We thank you that you pour out your blessings again and again and again. Our hands are open. We are grateful to receive them. And we pray that you would bless and accept and multiply this offering, that through it many may know your hope, and many may know your help, and many may know you. We ask this in Jesus' name. And all God's people said, amen.
Give me one pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Jesus, give me one glorious ambition for my life, to know and follow hard after you. Give me one pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Give me one glorious ambition for my life, to know and follow her. invite you to stand now as you're able to join with us in singing this one pure and holy passion. We sing together.
Give me one pure and holy passion. Give me one magnificent obsession. Jesus, give me one glorious ambition for my life. To know and follow after you. To know and follow.
Amen. I invite you to take the Bible you brought with you or one that is near you in the pew. If you've got one on your phone or your tablet, that is fantastic. You're absolutely welcome to use those as well. And we are going to be in Matthew chapter 13 today. Matthew chapter 13. Our bishop, Bishop Tom Berlin, he's the bishop of the Florida Conference of the United Methodist Church, has asked every pastor in the Florida Conference to preach this brand new sermon series that we're starting today. It's called Wesleyan Rooted. And over the next few weeks, we're going to explore some key beliefs and practices from our branch of the Christian family tree. And so we're going to start today with grow deeply. And the passage we're going to use is Matthew 13. Matthew 13 is a collection of Jesus' parables. A parable is a story with a deeper meaning. Parables are elastic. They're flexible. You can read a parable at one point in your life, read it again at a different point, and you're going to get something different out of it. You can have a bunch of people in the same room reading the same parable, and the Holy Spirit is going to speak to folks differently. There isn't just one way when it comes to a parable. So, Matthew chapter 13. This is the first parable in all of those parables that come in Matthew 13. We're going to start at verse 3. And Jesus told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow." Okay, so I'm going to stop there for a minute. And put this on. Okay, so a sower went out to sow, not a sower went out to sow, but a sower like seeds, right? Like a farmer, okay? A sower went out to sow, and as they sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on the rocky ground where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen. So, a parable. It's called usually the parable of the soils. And so you're thinking, okay, I'm going to need to concentrate on the soils because it's called the parable of the soils. So one interpretation would be that the soil is your heart. And so you need to examine your heart. Is your heart hard like the path? Is the good news of Jesus just easily dismissed by you, or is it just stolen away? Or is your heart rocky? Is your faith shallow? Does it have no root? Does it wither in the heat of commitment or sacrifice? Is your heart full of thorns, that your faith feels choked by cares and worries and circumstances? Or is your heart good and lasting soil, and it is producing abundant and good fruit? That is an absolute valid way of looking at this parable. And I have heard it preached that way many, many times. And when I'm in a season like I'm in right now, and I hear that interpretation of the parable, it feels like pressure. It feels like somebody is wagging a finger at me. It feels like, examine yourself and make a good choice and make a change. And when I was first new to faith and a different branch of the family tree, there were lots of sermons like that. And it would start me questioning. If I'm not good soil, then maybe I'm too far gone to be a child of God. If I'm not producing good fruit right now, then maybe I have lost God's welcome and God's love. There was a lot of you know, walk the aisle and give your heart to Jesus, which I did when I was 16 years old. And there was a lot of, you know, stay on the path. You've got to stay on the path. And there was just a lot of fear in that first church experience that I had. And so our branch of the family tree, we read the scriptures through a lens of grace, that the thread of the whole story of the Bible is grace, grace and grace and grace and grace. It doesn't mean that we don't have seasons of self-reflection, because we absolutely need those. It doesn't mean that that we don't need correction. We absolutely do that. But there is no condemnation in Christ. We don't read the scriptures through this lens of condemnation. We read it through this lens of grace. And so, what if maybe in this season, we look at it in a different way? Maybe we're not just one kind of soil. Maybe we're all of them. That we have times in our life where we are hard-hearted. We have times in our life where things are rocky and shallow and no root. And we have times when we are full of thorns and cares and worries and stress. And we have times when there is a good soil. Just like the cycle of farming, where there is time to plant seed, and there is time when that seed roots, and there is time when that seed begins to sprout, and then it is cultivated, and it is nurtured, and it grows, and there is time when there is a harvest. We go through these cycles. We go through these seasons in our faith, and these seasons in our life. And just because we're in a season that may not be at fruit, or a season that is really hard, it does not mean we are no longer a follower of God. Who can separate us from the love of God? Nothing. No one. It can't happen. It is grace, 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 grace. Following Jesus isn't a single moment of decision. It is not one and done. When I walked the aisle when I was 16 and gave my heart to Jesus, I was not done. God had plans for me. And I needed a lot of grace and growth and all of that. And the same is true for you. That there is a calling on your life and there is a plan for your life. And there are spiritual gifts that God has given you. It is not one and done. And so it's this growth in grace, this growing deeply, is a continuing, transforming power of Christ at work in us, where we are being undone and redone over and over again. And there will be seasons of all these different kinds of soils. It is messy. This following Jesus. It is challenging. It is beautiful. It is surprising, this life of growth in grace. And so someone along the way said, this is called the parable of the soils. And so we focus in on the soil. What if it was called the parable of the sower? What if we shifted our gaze to the one who is sowing the seeds? When Jesus told this story, the folks would have been shocked. They would have been shocked because a wise farmer would just sow the seed on the soil. You know, why is there seed being sown on the path and sown on the thorns and sown on the rocks and on the it's everywhere. But this is our understanding of grace. This is our understanding of grace. That there is grace for when we are brand new in our faith. When we don't even know there is a God, or we're going at God. There is grace. God reaching out to us. Reaching out to us in love. There's grace. We call it prevenient grace, right? The grace that goes before us. And then there's grace for that time in our life when we're like, oh my goodness, I can't save myself. I can't do enough good things to save myself. I am going to place my trust in Jesus as the leader of my life and the forgiver of my life and the savior of my life. We call this justifying grace, and Jesus is going to help me be rooted and grounded in him. And so there will be roots starting from those seeds that were planted earlier. And there will be some sprouting. There will be some growth. And there's grace for that. And then we've been walking with Jesus for a while. And we're like, okay, there's going to be some nurturing. And there's going to be some cultivating. And there's going to be some pruning. And, all of those things need to happen. And there will be fruit. And there is grace for that. There is grace for the rocks, and there is grace. We need the rocks. Grace for the thorns, and grace for the hardness, and grace for the, oh, it's in there. Grace for the fruit. Right? It is grace upon grace upon grace. And it is this journey of faith, these seasons. These cycles of faith and growth and doubts and questions and learning and pruning and fruit. And it is so living. It is alive. It is not one and done. One and done is stuck and just in place. But it is alive. It is organic. It is growth. It is grace. Because if we are honest, there are times when the crops fail, right? And there are times when the harvest is plentiful. Colossians 2, verses 6 through 7 says this. As therefore you have received Christ Jesus the Lord, the grace is a gift. Oh, we need another one for that. The grace is a gift, right? Just as you have received Christ Jesus, you have received the gift. Continue. Notice, continue. To live your life in him, rooted and built up in him, and established in the faith, just as you were taught, abounding in thanksgiving. And 2 Corinthians 3. Let's back up one. Oops. I'll read it to you. 2 Corinthians 3, beginning at verse 17. Now the Lord is the Spirit. Where the Spirit of Lord is, there is freedom. Verse 18, and all of us, there it is, with unveiled faces, right? We don't have to put on the happy face, you know, that everything's all right. Or we don't have to put on the I'm super spiritual face. No, no, unveiled. Vulnerable, our true selves, with unveiled faces, seeing the glory of the Lord as though reflected in a mirror, we are being transformed. It's a process. We're in the middle of it. We're in the middle of the season and the cycle. Are being transformed into the same image from one degree of glory to another. It's a process. It's a journey. It's a cycle. For this comes from the Lord, the Spirit. So this idea of grow deeply is growth in grace. The grace that is provided to us no matter who we are, no matter where we are. The grace that sees us through the rocks, sees us through the thorns, sees us through the hardness, provides so that we may exercise our faith in good fruit, lasting fruit. Nothing can separate us from the love of God. Nothing. And so, what grace do you need today? Do you need the grace of new life and new beginnings? Do you need the grace of consolation and comfort? Do you need the grace that carries you? Do you need the grace that empowers you? Do you need saving grace? It's there for you. Let's pray. God, we thank you that you are a God of grace, that we do not need to fear you, fear veering off in the wrong direction, that you are there, leading, guiding, drawing us forward. We're grateful that nothing can separate us from you. We thank you for reaching out to us again and again, and for the growth that comes in you. We thank you that this growth is not just for us, but for our community and for our world. That the hope is for all, the saving love is for all. Extend your grace to us and all today. I invite your prayers.
My name is Roberta Fowler. Would you please pray with me? Jesus, Lord of life, conqueror of death, you sow the seed of your good news extravagantly, generously. Some cry foolish, we cry glory. You sow your word, your promises, your justice, your salvation, yourself. Glory to your grace and mercy. Save us from shallow faith, stagnant faith. Save us from all that wants to choke and steal faith. Glory to your deliverance and power. In you we grow up and increase the yield. We bear your good and lasting fruit. Glory to your faithfulness and future. May all people who know your saving love and hope, may all people live the prayer that you taught us. Please pray the Lord's Prayer with me. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory. Amen. Okay, now we're ready for the announcements. You're invited to a special online conference-wide study of the book Upward by Paul Chilcote and Steve Harper. Together we'll explore what it means to be the Wesleyan rooted as we look at the heights and practices of our branch of the Christian family tree. The class features videos with Paul and Steve done specifically for this study and small group conversation to share our insights and apply what we've learned. The session will be Zoom on Saturdays from 8:30 a.m. to 10 a.m. starting October 5th. All are welcome. See the midweek newsletter for the registration link or contact the church office. There's a Feeding the Soul Women's Book Club, which resumes Wednesday, October the 2nd. Now's a great time to join. The group meets on the first and third Wednesdays at 4 p.m. in the chapel. Soul Strollers, a new small group grounded in community, walking, and prayer starts today. They'll meet at 4 p.m. at New Smyrna Dunes Park for the next 5 weeks. They'll start with a 35-minute walk around the 1.5-mile boardwalk loop and then gather for prayer. If you're unable to walk that far, walk as far as you can and then enjoy the park until the rest of the group returns. All are welcome.
Lifts your name.
God, for your amazing grace.
Beloved of God, what is our mission? Building community rooted in God's love, inviting all to grow in Christ, engaging with service and compassion. Friends, we hope that you will stick around for a little while. We hope that you'll just stay in here and greet one another and have great conversations and encourage one another. And so go now, go to love, go to serve. Go and share the grace that has found you. Go with the blessing and hope of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
I invite you to join with us in our closing chorus. Go now in peace.
Go now in peace.